Tentor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Bing and Billy and Frank and Ella and Judy and Barbara by Dan Callahan. Narrated by Paul Bellantoni. Introduction. The Democracy of American Music. By the early 20th century, the songwriters of what was known as Tin Pan Alley had sheet music of their songs readily available to the general public at 10 cents a copy. A young Irving Berlin got his start as a song plugger, demonstrating and pitching new songs in saloons and music stores. And George Gershwin and Jerome Kern were also pitching songs and making music spread as far and wide as possible. Lillian Hardin Armstrong worked as a song plugger and promoted her own songs, like Just for a Thrill, and the career of her husband, Louis, who apprenticed with the cornetist, bandleader, and songwriter Joe King Oliver, one of the pioneers of a new kind of music called jazz. Music began to be everywhere in America in the 1910s and early 1920s, played at home with extended family gathered around the piano, in bar rooms and later speakeasies, and then on record and on the radio, on the street, coming from windows, listened to through the day and at night, rousing people to action, making happy people even happier and sad people even sadder. This was both a heightening of life and a heightening of possibility. That great American lure that says, you can change your life, or even life might change. Music was now open in some form to everyone in America. Blues, opera, classical, operetta, popular, novelty songs, songs about love, songs about mother love, songs to sell war, songs to escape with. There was Let Me Call You Sweetheart, Alexander's Ragtime Band, I'm Always Chasing Rainbows, Look for the Silver Lining, Downhearted Blues, The Donkey Serenade, I Cried for You, Nobody Knows You When You're Down and Out, and Fascinating Rhythm. You might work all day and then go to your bedroom and listen to the broadcasts on the radio from famous ballrooms in populous cities. You could be there. The music from the radio and on records meant that nobody needed to be entirely alone now. People could dream. They could reminisce. They could cry their heart out, and it would be a good cry. And they could get up and dance, for the new American music of the 1910s and 1920s, first ragtime and then jazz and swing, was the music of celebration and liberation. There were dance crazes like the Castle Walk and the Foxtrot, and beyond this were the Shimmy, the Charleston, and the Lindy Hop, and a deliverance from corsets for women. This was an age of fast-paced or hot music that even came to be known as the Jazz Age, and it ran on bootleg liquor, nerve, and dance bands of some kind at schools and grand ballrooms where men and women could meet, take a turn around the floor, an experiment. Pleasure-loving flappers could cart around a phonograph and a few of their favorite records. In the movie Sadie Thompson, 1928, a hypocritical reformer named Davidson, Lionel Barrymore, is driven to heights of judgmental fury whenever Gloria Swanson's Sadie plays her jazz records over and over again. The bad girl heroines of 1920s and early 1930s movies always seem to have a phonograph and a few hot records to aggravate the puritanical men and women around them. And it is clear they get a kick out of this, as if they're saying, ain't nothing you can do about it, dearie. Once that window to music for everyone was opened, it could never be closed again, not by moralizing or classism, or racism, or sexism. This book is about that window being opened even further, and the fight for freedom and equality that it eventually led to. It is also about the way a human singing voice can be a directly amorous spur to the deepest of desires and fantasies, and how it can be a bond of friendship or fellowship, and how it can ascend to the highest form of all-seeing and objective art, the sound of the right singing voice can reach out slowly and touch us, and it can feel like fingers gently caressing our flesh. Can this be? Yes, the voice says. Yes, it can, and it will, and it is. 1. Bing. Out of nowhere. The story begins with a voice on the radio. The voice is low, rough even, a baritone, urgent, throbbing, and sexy. Those who only know the later Bing Crosby might be taken aback by his vocal for Out of Nowhere, which he recorded on March 30, 1931. He is not playing it safe here, as he increasingly did by the early 1940s. This record has a feeling of it's now or never, and he's betting everything on it. Crosby had been a singer with the Paul Whiteman Orchestra as one of the rhythm boys, with his partners Harry Barris and Al Renker, but he was going out on his own now, out on a limb. He begins Out of Nowhere softly, intimately, singing sweet somethings directly into our ear, as if he's making his pitch at a crowded party and has taken each of us into some corner of it. The voice on this record is trying to observe some modicum of propriety, but youthful ardor and copious amounts of liquor have their way, and Crosby is soon singing full out, like one of his idols, the Irish tenor John McCormack. But then, about 2 minutes into the song, he decides to pull way back on the volume, and the effect he gets from this pulling back is enough to make anyone weak in the knees from hearing it. Crosby is singing at full tilt again by the end of the song, which has a lyric by Edward Heyman, who wrote the words to Body and Soul. Technically, he's using dynamics, controlling the volume of his voice so that when he decides to sing softly after singing full out, it cannot help but be felt as a plea and a winning strategy. He uses a lot more vibrato as a young man than he will in the future. And he also uses his early trademark, a mordant, a slight fluctuation between notes. Crosby is both laying himself bare here and asserting his own power and command. It took guts to sing Out of Nowhere the way he did. He was done fooling around. Crosby was throwing his hat into the ring now, and he changed and transformed American popular music with his hip, intimate style of singing. When he recorded Out of Nowhere for Brunswick Records, Crosby was singing with the Gus Arnheim band at the Coconut Grove in Hollywood, and he was making important contacts while also drinking and carousing, sometimes with his friend Louis Armstrong, who was also playing in that area at Frank Sebastian's Cotton Club. Every night between their outfit and our outfit, we used to burn up the air. Every night, said Louis. Yeah, Bing and Gus Arnheim and co. would broadcast first every night and leave the ether wave sizzling hot, just right for us when we would burst on in there from the Cotton Club. Oh, it was lots of fun. The same listeners would catch both programs before going to bed. When their respective bands were done broadcasting, Louis and Bing would get together to jam. After Bing, the band, Mr. Arnheim, and the boys would finish work at the Grove. They would haul ashes over to the Cotton Club, where we would be playing and swing with us, until Home Sweet Home was played, Louis said. Louis captures the Bing look of this time. Sometimes he would come over wearing his Sharp uniform, the one I admired so much. It was a hard-hitting blue with white buttons, which made him look, to me, like a young captain on some high-powered yacht. Lots of women had Bing's attention then, but he was most focused on one beautiful singer who would become his first wife. That's when he and Dixie Lee were canoeing, said Louis. Louis and Bing idolized each other, and their mutual admiration society lasted all the rest of their lives. In this period, early in 1931, when Bing's records were making him into a star, they were close enough that Bing asked Louie and his band to come to the train station to serenade Dixie Lee after she got back from shooting a movie on the East Coast. Oh, Daddy Bing, Harry Barris and Al Rinker, they gave me all sorts of inducements, etc., to just go down to the station and sort of toot a few hot ones as she hit the ground from the train, Louie said. But he had amorous plans of his own for that evening and had to decline. Music as a means of seduction was something that Bing was making use of in life and also on the air in 1931. In January, he had recorded one of his first hits, I Surrender, Dear, which has an intricate and expressive arrangement with a Gershwin flavor to it. Bing is singing here of a Frank Sinatra-Ava Gardner-type relationship, where fighting is the spice that keeps things lively, but the couple has reached an impasse and stopped speaking, and so Bing is surrendering, with a mordant on Dear. He is making himself appealingly vulnerable, but not abject, as Sinatra so often did in his own vocals. For the persona that Bing created is far too proud for that. He is almost never lovelorn on record. The early Bing, more than anything, is out for pleasure. The scapegrace Bing revealed on the song One More Time, which he recorded in between I Surrender, Dear and Out of Nowhere, might come as a real shocker to those who only know the older man and his Christmas specials. After over a minute of swinging intro, Bing comes in with, Oh, my pretty baby, one more time, bubum, just one more time. That bubum, in between phrases, shows the kind of rhythmic inventiveness that he was capable of in this period, which gave his vocals such an exciting feeling of recklessness. You can spend my dough, you can drink my gin, you can snap the lock if you'll let me in, he promises. Bing conquered America musically in 1931, and his other records included At Your Command, with just a Harry Barris piano accompaniment for his impassioned and emotional vocal, and I Apologize. He was winning over a female audience with these tunes in 1931, and strategizing so that he could win the men later. When he made this first decisive impact, Bing was a dream man on the radio, an undressed sound. He apologizes, he surrenders, he's at your command. Bing's ardent vocals promised fun and a little trouble and an intensity that left a crooner like Rudy Valley with his thin, prim, ghostly voice in the dust. That the visual he could offer didn't quite match the sexual urgency of the voice was something that Bing was well aware of, which is why he so often looks sheepish in his early 1930s movies. When he sings Out of Nowhere in Confessions of a Coed, 1931, a Sylvia Sidney vehicle at Paramount, his hair looks strange, for he had started losing it very early in life and didn't have convincing hair pieces yet. His face is apprehensive, but he is still calm enough to break off singing his great makeout song to say hello after being greeted by Philip Holmes, who is dancing by with Sidney. Bing had been educated by Jesuits, so he was trained to cast a cold eye on life, and it was this essential coolness that set him apart. It made him hip enough to know that Louis Armstrong was a musical genius and the foundation for a new way of singing, and it also kept him steady for decades when so many others faltered. He became increasingly removed, held back, and suburban, but he started out in 1931 as a naked voice on the radio, and that voice is still very winning and very seductive, like a first boyfriend with bad boy tendencies who drives you crazy, but always has you coming back for more. 2. Bing. Just one more chance. Bing's father was known around Spokane, Washington as Happy Harry, and he wasn't a guy who let work or responsibilities stand in the way of a good time. He was something like the free-spirited characters Bing often played in his 1930s movies like Pennies from Heaven, 1936. Bing's strict and forbidding Irish mother, Kate, was the disciplinarian of the household, and she had to be, for Harry made little money, and she had 7 children to bring up. At one point, Happy Harry bought a phonograph with money that might have been intended for groceries, but this was a music-loving family, so Kate didn't stay angry for long. There were several versions of how Bing got his unusual name, but the true story is that the young Harry Lillis Crosby, Jr., born in 1903, loved a local paper called the Bingville Bugle, and especially a comic feature in it called Bingo from Bingville. A friend and neighbor named Valentine Hobart started calling him Bingo from Bingville, and this eventually got shortened to Bing. At Gonzaga High School, where he received his Jesuit education, Bing took lessons in elocution, and he was someone who delighted in words for their own sake, which became one of the most distinctive features of his persona, particularly on the radio. He had a near-photographic memory, was an expert all-around athlete, and was also an altar boy in the Catholic Church. Even in the most dissipated days of his youth, Bing always tried to make it to Sunday Mass. He could be diffident, but deep down, Bing was ambitious, and this came out in a poem he wrote while in school where he dreamed of being an adored and indolent king surrounded by wealth. The Crosby family enthused to John McCormack and Caruso records at home, but Bing was most impressed by seeing Al Jolson live at a Spokane theater where he was working as a property boy one summer. Jolson came from a Jewish family. His father was a rabbi and a cantor in a synagogue, so his style of singing out came from that tradition. But when he was still in his teens, Jolson started performing his shows in blackface, a grotesque holdover from the minstrel era of the 19th century. He was billed at that time as the world's greatest entertainer, and he was wowing Spokane in his smash hit musical Robinson Crusoe, Jr., in which he played a resourceful chauffeur named Gus, a character Jolson had assumed in several earlier shows. Jolson's voice sounds both corny and studied on records, and in surviving footage from 1926, where he sings some of his hits while wearing blackface. His fake, intimate, cajoling style is odious. The popularity of blackface in the early 20th century cannot be ignored, although too often it is written out of the history of some of America's most beloved performers. Any form of history that gets suppressed or repressed or erased out, it comes back to haunt, said critic Margot Jefferson. Some of this came out of a genuine fascination with the music, the songs, the dances, the performance styles of black people. You can be fascinated, you can be excited, but you can always feel superior. Bing was riveted as he watched Jolson seize the stage, rushing around and ad-libbing lines and even song lyrics. Seeing Jolson excited Bing about the possibilities of performing, but the influence of Jolson vocally only comes out in some of his early recordings. The decisive influence on him in the 1920s would be a real black man, not an imitation, the fabled Louis. Yet the influence of Jolson as a performer would prove hard to shake off for Bing. Bing and his friend Al Rinker played the drums for a band called the Musicolators, and they performed at high school dances and also entertained between movies at the Clemmer Theater. Bing was a few years older than Rinker, and he soon asserted himself after looking askance one day at the way Rinker was being bossy with the other band members. After one rehearsal, Bing came over to me and said, "You'd better not talk that way to me, or I'll give you a punch in the nose," Rinker remembered. Bing and Rinker would often spend all day listening to the latest records at a store in town called Russ Bailey's House of Music. "We practically live there," Bing said. remembering the impressions made by the recordings of the Mound City Blue Blowers, the original Memphis Five, and the original Dixieland Jazz Band. But the most important order of business for Bing and Al was to listen to certain Paul Whiteman records over and over again until they had learned the arrangements by ear. Rinker said that they would buy one record after memorizing 12 others. Bing drank and partied heavily at this time, and he and the band gladly accepted a gig at a shady dive called the Pekin Cafe. I was able to allay some of my mother's doubts about the restaurant's respectability by pointing to its most respectable financial rewards, Bing said. Though he went to college at Gonzaga University, Bing didn't get a degree. In October of 1925, Bing and Al Rinker set off for California, where Rinker's sister, Mildred Bailey, was living. Happy Harry wished them well, as did Kate, who had been unhappy about Bing quitting school. Harry later said that both he and Kate knew their son had some talent, so they didn't stand in his way when he went off on his own to sing with Rinker and make his fortune. Mildred Bailey was a vocalist herself and had known Bing in Spokane, where she sang in speakeasies, and to her he was something of a delinquent. "Bing was always a fella to get into trouble," she said in 1941. "I expect he spent every Saturday night of his life in jail." Bailey was a small woman, barely 5 feet tall, with a bright, sharp, intimate voice and a sure sense of rhythm. Both she and Rinker were of Native American heritage, and she introduced Bing to some new sounds on record, particularly Ethel Waters and Bessie Smith, getting him out of the white guy jazz pocket he had settled into at Russ Bailey's House of Music. A hip lady who always kept her eyes and especially her ears open, Bailey also told Bing when he reached Los Angeles with her brother that if he was serious about singing, he had to listen to Louis Armstrong. Louis was playing with the Fletcher Henderson Orchestra, and in November of 1925, he started making records with his own group, the Hot Five. His strong-willed wife, Lil, got him to quit the Henderson band to go out on his own, and she was one of the Hot Five herself on piano. She had billed him as the world's greatest trumpet player, much to his chagrin. But he was that, and much more. Maybe you had to be there for Al Jolson, the so-called world's greatest entertainer of his time, even if that's looking and sounding increasingly unlikely. But the legend of Louis, dead now for 50 years, is always expanding and ascending. Louis told the story later that he started to scat, a New Orleans term for wordless vocalizing, on the song Heebie Jeebies, because he dropped the lyrics and didn't want to spoil the take, and this song sold somewhere in the vicinity of 40,000 copies. Musicians like cornetist Bix Biederbeck, who was of German heritage, listened to Louis' records over and over again, laughing at his audacity and sense of fun. Speaking of his audience, Louis once said, "They know I'm there in the cause of happiness." Bing, in this period, was there for the cause of youthful hedonism, and he sometimes got so drunk that he fell off the platform where he was singing. If a heckler gave him a hard time, he was ready to jump off the bandstand and follow the guy outside. He did not have many serious girlfriends. When years later he met the young nephew of one girl that he had seen steadily in this period named Dorothy Bresnan, Bing wrote a charming note to her in remembrance of their romance. To pick up the slack at this time, he was an ardent customer of ladies of the evening. Inspired by Louis, Bing and Al were doing jazzy numbers and even scatting, a novelty on the vaudeville circuit. The band leader Paul Whiteman was similarly inspired by Louis, Duke Ellington, and Fletcher Henderson. After listening to these musicians intensively and talking to them, Whiteman concluded that the best jazz musicians were African American. But when Whiteman tried to hire black players for his band, his management told him he would lose all his bookings in the South. He was also told that the black players would be forced to accept separate accommodations and dining rooms. and so Whiteman compromised and hired black arrangers for his music. Whiteman's manager, Jimmy Gillespie, saw Bing and Al perform in late 1926 and spoke of them enthusiastically to Whiteman, who immediately hired them. Bing and Al soon left with the Whiteman band on a tour of the Midwest that took them to Chicago, where Whiteman brought Bing to hear Louie at the Sunset Cafe, which was run by Joe Glazer, an associate of Al Capone, who would eventually become Louie's manager. Bing was delighted by Louie's trumpet playing and singing, but he also loved his comic inventiveness, especially a routine Louie had worked up where he put on a frock coat and dark glasses and played a character called the Reverend Satchelmouth. This character stayed with Bing. "I'm proud to acknowledge my debt to the Reverend Satchelmouth," he said in 1950. "He is the beginning and the end of music in America, and long may he reign." Bing and Al were doing fairly well on the tour, but they laid an egg when they played at the Paramount Theater in New York in February of 1927, one of those unaccountable show business things having to do with audiences and what works for some and doesn't work for others. Young Bing was unfazed, set on his course of good times, and golf wherever he could play it. He had begun making records with the Whiteman Band, and took a solo vocal on the Southern ditty Muddy Water in March of 1927. His slightly hoarse voice really stands out on Changes, which features a hot solo from Bix Biederbeck, for as his definitive biographer Gary Giddens has observed, Bing was a baritone in a world of tenors. By April, Harry Barris joined their act, and they rejoined Whiteman as the Rhythm Boys. The musical Showboat opened at the end of 1927 and was an immediate success. Bing recorded two of the Jerome Kern and Oscar Hammerstein songs from that landmark show in 1928, Make Believe, fetchingly, if hoarsely, and Old Man River, inadequately. Jules Bledsoe, who played the role of Joe in this original production because Paul Robeson was unavailable, sings Old Man River in a very dramatic and dynamic way, hurling out words and notes as if they were challenges filled with rage and pride. By contrast, Bing sings his Old Man River to a fast and blithe Whiteman foxtrot arrangement for dancing that totally disregards the lyrics of the song. Aside from this, his low notes are not fully supported here. Blame it on his youth. Robeson also recorded Old Man River with Whiteman's band in 1928, and the fast tempo doesn't allow him to do everything he could with his signature song. Bing returned to Old Man River again on record in 1945 and sang it in his mature and distant style, and this at least has the benefit of a clearly objective point of view and pained respect for the lyrics. But then he mistakenly sang it again as a fast rhythm number in an anniversary special that aired in 1977, the year he died. Blame it on his age. Louis spoke very highly of a record that Bing made with Biederbeck in early 1928 called From Monday On, and Bing spoke admiringly of Biederbeck, who died young in 1931, for the rest of his life. Bing brings a distinct jazz flavor to You Took Advantage of Me, a Rodgers and Hart tune he recorded in April of 1928, playing with the melody on certain syllables in a way that feels liberatingly sexy. Once he had that jazz feeling, Bing was nearly incapable of singing a number straight. He plays with time on his 1929 record Louise, a catchy song introduced by Maurice Chevalier, taking the tempo faster than you expect it, which gives it a sense of danger. The Rhythm Boys were on tour in late 1928 and stopped in Chicago, where Bing made sure to see Louie again, and Louie went to see Bing play at the Sunset Cafe. Marijuana was legal then, and they both partook of it with regularity. Pot was a way of life for Louie, who did a song about it called Muggles. Speaking of how marijuana got him through and how it inspired friendships, Louie said it makes you forget all the bad things that happen to a Negro.
It makes you feel wanted, and when you're with another tea smoker, it makes you feel a special kinship.
During an interview with Barbara Walters at the end of his life, Bing startled his TV audience when he went from saying that he would never speak to his daughter Mary Frances again if she lived with a man without benefit of matrimony, to saying that he thought marijuana should be legalized. When he was angry at his son Gary for drinking too much, Bing once told him that he should smoke pot instead. Louis was as anti-alcohol as he was pro-pot. Louis wrote in later years about the excitement over Bing's singing in the jazz community. There were just as many colored people buying air, raving over Bing's recordings, as much as anybody else. The chicks, gals, were just a swooning and screaming when Bing would sing. The women were crazy for him, but the men who were serious about music were taking notice too.
I remember the first time a friend of mine in Chicago, he came to my house and said, "Man, there's a little cat coming up singing, you gotta dig him."
Louis remembered.
And that was my boy, Papa Bing.
Louis started doing Bing-like mordants, sometimes as a kind of tribute when he sang, which can be heard on late 1920s records like When You're Smiling. And Bing could growl like Louis, most notably on his 1931 recording of I Found a $1 Million Baby in a 5- and 10-cent store. They inspired each other while still remaining their own singular entities, and they changed over time, which Louis noted.
Bing's voice has a mellow quality that only Bing's got, Louis said to Time magazine in 1955. It's like gold being poured out of a cup.
The late 1920s was a period of experimentation for Bing. He would husband his vocal resources in later years, but it becomes apparent just how much voice he had on Great Day, recorded in late 1929, where he has the kind of confident, rounded tones of a semi-operatic baritone. He could likely have handled operetta roles, at least, if he had wanted to, and he would get around to Victor Herbert in the 1930s. The Rhythm Boys played the Palace Theater in New York, the top gig for anyone in vaudeville, and Bing had a near miss at this time. After a 48-hour bender that found him waking up in a strange hotel room, Bing went to the bathroom just in time to miss being sprayed by machine gun fire from the front door. The other men inside were wounded but not killed, and Bing stayed in the bathroom for what seemed hours until a cop came up, whereupon Bing learned that he was in the hideout of Machine Gun Jack McGurn, a Capone mobster who had cut the throat of singer Joe E. Lewis. The Rhythm Boys traveled to California to appear with Whiteman in the lavish color feature King of Jazz, 1930, at Universal. Bing sings solo under the credits, selling the charms of music from a symphony grand by Schubert or Brahms to a popular band or a uke neath the palms. This mix of the old and the new would be borne out by this oddball and certainly overproduced film.
"Ah, tell it," cries Bing as encouragement when the Rhythm Boys do a number, his problem hair mitigated by his blue eyes and playful physicality.
Bing's jazzy modernity here is set off by John Bowles, who sings It Happened in Monterey with pompous declamations and rolled R's. Bowles took over a number that Bing was supposed to sing in King of Jazz called Song of the Dawn, after Bing got arrested for drunk driving. He practically drove through the lobby of the Roosevelt Hotel in Hollywood, said singer Bobby Brox, who eventually married the songwriter Jimmy Van Heusen. Jimmy Gillespie bailed Bing out of jail, and he arrived in court the following week, fresh from the golf course, snazzily but slightly eccentrically attired in his usual motley of colors and patterns. Bing was colorblind. The judge asked him if he had heard about Prohibition, and Bing said something sassy in response, either only remotely or, "Yes, but nobody pays much attention to it," which was his preferred line of dialogue for this story when he told it as an older man. Bing was sentenced to 60 days, and it was only after much behind-the-scenes maneuvering that he was allowed to continue filming King of Jazz under police escort.
Determined to appear in the movies, Bing had made some screen tests, but was turned down by Fox because of the way his ears stuck out. The best he could do at this point was an appearance with the Rhythm Boys in a short called 2 Plus 4s, 1930, a film that is notable for the way Bing stands up for a very sympathetic older Jewish character, and a moment where he waves his hand and cries, "Oh, hush," in a Nance way that shows how hip and in the know he was. He then made a brief appearance singing during a whoopee party scene in Edmund Goulding's Reaching for the Moon, 1930, a vehicle for Douglas Fairbanks. In September of 1930, Bing married Dixie Lee, who as a singer at that time was somewhat better known than he was, and this was a key step in his move to settle down and become the king he had dreamed of being in school. The following year, when he was making his first huge impact as a solo artist on records, Bing began appearing in a series of short films for comedy director Max Sennett, starting with I Surrender, Dear, which was named for his star-making hit song. He is playing a version of himself here, singing I Surrender, Dear at the Coconut Grove, and this movie makes comic hay out of the fact that a lot of Bing's audience didn't know what he looked like yet. He was just a very seductive voice on the radio in this crucial transitional period. This early screen Bing is a cut-up and a scamp, and he's a camp, too, ironically calling a jealous butch guy a pansy. He pantomimes to his own recording of Out of Nowhere, and he's very good at being silly, which does match an aspect of his radio voice image, the unreliable but fun, good-time guy. His rough speaking voice is just as sexy as his singing voice, and all of these things serve to distract us from possible stumbling blocks like his hair problem, his ears, and his round waistline, which spoke to a less visually attractive aspect of his hedonism. Bing is followed by adoring women in his next Sennett short, One More Chance, 1931, where he sings one of his many hit songs from that year, Wrap Your Troubles in Dreams, and the title tune, Just One More Chance, which he does in a very jazzy and rhythmic freewheeling Louie fashion to a girl at a table in a club. Billboard Girl, 1932, is a short that pushes Bing the camp to his outer limits. His character is selling magazines in order to go to college, and he's engaged to a girl named Mary, Marjorie Kane. Mary's naughty brother Freddie, James Eagles, pretends to be his sister over the phone with Bing, and they make kissing sounds at each other. "Don't queer it," Freddie says to his friends as he tries to finish this phone call. The none-too-masculine Freddie gets into female drag and pretends to be Mary again so that Bing can pitch some woo to him, and Bing nearly kisses him. All of which suggests that horny Nances must have liked Bing as much as so many of the women in America did. He had his own show now on the radio, too, so Bing was everywhere in 1931, conquering all aspects of mass media, goofing around on screen, crooning and seducing over the airwaves and on record, and providing comfort during the worst years of the Depression. His theme song on the radio, Where the Blue of the Night Meets the Gold of the Day, is meant to soothe listeners and ready them for sleep, where troubles could be wrapped in dreams like a warm blanket. But this early Bing could also provoke, and the way he often does that is with his daring sense of time. Listen to the way he somehow slips in the phrase, "'Cause I'll never stand for that," on the song, "'I'm Gonna Get You," and the breakneck way he ends it with a super-fast decrescendo on the words, "Wait till you see what I'm going to do to you, babe." Bing's rhythmic inventiveness signaled then, and still signals, we don't need to follow the rules. And of course, playing hide-and-seek with a beat of a song and filling it with as many extra notes as possible has a very sexy effect. Bing signed with Paramount Pictures, partly because he had befriended Gary Cooper, and that was Cooper's studio. He played a version of himself in his first feature for Paramount, The Big Broadcast, 1932, which collects a lineup of radio stars of that time like Kate Smith, George Burns, and Gracie Allen, and the dynamic Boswell sisters, plus Cab Calloway and the Mills Brothers, with whom Bing had a number one hit in Dinah, one of his most delightful early records. He starts it slow, but once the Mills brothers take the song up with a fast tempo a little over a minute in, Bing offers up a scat break and then slips in hip, encouraging phrases as the brothers come back in. Sell it, and snag it, and ah, tell it. Frank Tuttle, the director of the big broadcast and several of Bing's subsequent 1930s movies, introduced him to screenwriter John Bright, who was raising money to defend nine young black men falsely accused of rape down in Scottsboro, Alabama. Bright remembered Bing responding, "Nine colored boys in the South accused of rape? They didn't do it. How much do you want?" He wrote out a check to Bright for $1,000. In the 1930s, Bing leaned left and was progressive by instinct. Bing is attacked by a mob of female fans at the start of the big broadcast, so his face is covered in lipstick kisses as he does a bit of "I Surrender, Dear" on the air. He is late for his show, which plays on Bing's own reputation at this time for unreliability. A blonde secretary who is in love with him calls him everybody's type, and he looks better than he ever has here with a full toupee and his ears pinned back. The Bing in this movie is all over the place emotionally, even considering suicide fairly seriously. "You sing into a little hole year after year, and then you die," he says. And this isn't really played for comedy. The 1932 Bing is a heavy drinker and a moody romantic who might fall so deeply in love with a woman that his heart will get broken and never mend. He speaks the lyrics to "Here Lies Love" before starting to sing them, which emphasizes his sincerity as a singer and the way he made singing as intimate as whispered conversation. The words of a lyric are just as important to Bing as the music, and sometimes more so. The vocal trouble that had caused some raspiness during his Whiteman days had started to vanish or come under his control. A node had been discovered on his vocal cords, but doctors advised against having it operated on, and this accounts for some of the pleasingly virile roughness of his tone in this period. Bing scatted on several other of his 1932 records, like Sweet Georgia Brown and Some of These Days, Sophie Tucker's signature song, which Bing made his scapegrace near-ne'er-do-well own. But this was the same year he recorded a pained acknowledgement of the Depression, "Brother, Can You Spare a Dime?" This story song is early Bing at his most engaged, with just a hint of distance to make it universal. The Bingian subtext of "Brother, Can You Spare a Dime?" is that if you do what people tell you to do, they'll use you and toss you aside on the trash. Go to war, and what was that for? The character he is playing in this song is named Al, and nobody can even remember his name now that he's down and out. Bing's Al is angry, yet he can't let go of his nostalgia for the past either. This is a very complicated song, and Bing explores every facet of it, ending on a surge in volume and full voice that dies off just slightly at the end. The perfect choice. Bing had made it to the top of his profession in 1932, and now he was tasked with speaking for everyone. 3. Billie's Blues. Sadie Fagan met Clarence Holliday at a dance or a carnival when she was 19 years old, and she never got over him. Sadie had his child, born Eleonora Fagan, on April 7, 1915, in Philadelphia, after being kicked out of her Baltimore home by her parents for getting pregnant. A man named Frank DeVries is listed as the father on Eleonora's birth certificate, but he was likely just a friend whose name was put down as a formality. It is almost certain that Clarence was Eleonora's father. Clarence was a musician and played the banjo, and he was off touring when Eleonora was born. Sadie brought Eleonora back to Baltimore to live with her half-sister, Eva Miller. but Eleonora had almost no supervision as a young girl. There is a photo of her at age 2 where she stands in a white dress with a white flower on her head, and the look on her face is adult, scarred, demanding. This is a face that already does not like what it sees of life. Eleonora felt that the haughty Fagans had rejected her mother and her, and this feeling of rejection went deep. When some of her mother's side of the family came to see her sing in later years, she was heard to say, "As far as I'm concerned, all the Fagans are dead." When they got up to leave in a huff, one of the women cried over her shoulder, "You're the one who's dead, girl." This story comes from Eleonora's Uncle Johnny, Sadie's brother, who later said how much he enjoyed his niece singing "I Cover the Waterfront" in later years, for it was redolent of her rough seaport upbringing in Baltimore. At age 9, Eleonora was brought before juvenile court for playing hooky and was sent to reform school at the House of the Good Shepherd, where she was called Madge, as if to let her be reborn. Eleonora slash Madge was remembered as a sullen child. "Always down in the dumps, very seldom had anything to do with nobody else," said Christine Scott, who worked at the school. But Scott remembered that little Madge's face brightened up when she was told that she was going to be baptized. "She was grinning from ear to ear, you could almost see her back teeth," said Scott. "She was just light as a feather, she was so tickled." Eleonora was paroled and moved with Sadie to the bottom of the point, the wrong side of the tracks in Baltimore. Sadie got them electricity and gas, and they opened a restaurant, the kind of venture Sadie tended to enjoy the most. Sadie had her proper Fagin side, but she was also capable of running after a man with a pistol, whereas her young daughter was all bad girl and rebel, at least on the outside. Eleonora's friend Ethel Moore operated a good time house in the neighborhood, and so Eleonora started making use of that as a money-making opportunity from a very early age, stealing men's wallets from their pants. She was tall, already a big, noble-looking girl, according to Wee Wee Hill, the man that Sadie once went after with a gun, and she wanted fast money. In her ghost-written 1956 autobiography, Lady Sings the Blues, she describes washing steps outside houses for cash. But her friends of this time didn't remember her scrubbing steps much. Sadie sometimes worked as a maid, and Eleonora had nothing but scorn for that kind of work for herself. At Alice Dean's sporting house, Eleonora listened to blues records on what they called the graphophone. She listened to Florence Mills and Mamie Smith and Bessie Smith, and she loved the low, powerful sound that Bessie had. Eleonora was singing in the streets right from the start. A man from this time named Freddie remembered her singing along to the records he would put on. "Eleonora always liked the sad ones," he said. "She was getting a meal, missing a meal, catching a trick or two," said her friend Pony Kane. Some of the adults around her tried to get her to be a good girl, but she went about her business getting herself a bad name regardless. Wee Wee Hill said of Eleonora, "You know the kind of people that say, 'I'm going to get cussed out anyways, so what's the difference? What the hell?' Well, Eleonora just went out and done what she felt like doing because she was just don't care-ish." On Christmas Eve 1926, Sadie and Wee Wee walked in on a 40-year-old man named Wilbur Rich attempting to rape the 11-year-old Eleonora. Rich was arrested and received a custodial sentence of just 3 months, and Eleonora was sent back to the House of the Good Shepherd, where she was held until February of 1927. Eleonora had to prove her toughness physically time and again at Good Shepherd, where fights between the girls happened regularly. When Eleonora got out, she was on her own, unsupervised at age 12, drinking and smoking reefer and out for a good time. Pony Kane described how Eleonora would be outside on the streets feeling high and feeling good, and would just come out with the worst word she knew just for attention. "You motherfucker, cocksucker, kiss my ass, kiss my ass," she would say, getting up in men's faces until they chased her and beat her. "She must have liked the men beating on her," said Pony. "The fellas that was crazy for her she didn't have no time for, and the ones that have somebody else was the ones she wanted." In the midst of all this outward chaos and perversity, the proud and sensitive interior Eleonora found a new way of expressing herself. "I heard a record Louis Armstrong made called The West End Blues," she said, "and he doesn't say any words, and I thought, this is wonderful, and I liked the feeling he got from it. Sometimes the record would make me so sad I'd cry up a storm. Other times the same damn record would make me so happy." Sadie was living in Harlem, while her daughter was roaming the streets and drinking and living by her wits in Baltimore, and finally Eleonora was sent to join her mother in early 1929. They lived in a brothel run by Florence Williams at 151 West 140th Street, and it wasn't long before they were both arrested on May 2, 1929. Sadie was released from a workhouse in July, and Eleonora was released from Welfare Island in October. In 1930, Sadie and Eleonora lived in Brooklyn. But then they moved back to Harlem. Eleonora was making the rounds of the nightclubs and singing, doing songs like "Honeysuckle Rose" and "How Am I to Know" and "My Fate Is in Your Hands." She would sometimes see her father, Clarence, who was playing guitar for Fletcher Henderson. He was known then for his sense of time. He was just a rhythm man. He had that left foot going, stomping, yes, he did. He had all that going, and he was swinging, said drummer Jimmy Crawford of Clarence. It was proposed at one point that Eleonora might move in with Clarence and his wife Fanny, who described the girl as "a fat thing with big titties," when she first met her. Though Fanny liked Eleonora, she felt that this tough young teenager was too uncontrollable to live with, and Fanny couldn't stand Sadie, who made trouble as often as possible for the easygoing Clarence, chasing after him and causing scenes and looking for attention from him any way she could get it. Singer May Barnes said that Eleonora was covering a lot of Louis Armstrong tunes at the various clubs. "She was doing everything that Louis Armstrong was doing," said Barnes. "She knew his records backwards, every one of them. She wasn't imitating his styles, she was using all his numbers. She always had this deep voice. She could do it just like him because she has this heavy voice, this gravelly tone, even when she had her own style. I Surrender, Dear, she'd slide and do the Louis run as if he'd do it on the trumpet." Barnes also remembered Eleonora singing "Them Their Eyes," which stayed in her repertoire for the rest of her life. It was at this time that Eleonora changed her name to Billie and took her father's last name for her own stage name. She tried out Halliday for a while, but then settled on Holiday. She said later that she chose the first name because she admired the beautiful movie star Billie Dove, but she might also have been thinking of her friend Billie Haywood, a comedian and singer. Barnes and Billie worked together at The Nest on 133rd Street in Harlem, a bar where the singers would sometimes take the tips off the tables with their vaginas. "That's the kind of club it was," Barnes said. But she said that Billie wasn't that type and took the tips with her hand. Billie, Barnes, and Haywood would finish singing around 7 or 8 o'clock in the morning, and then they'd head to the gin mills until noon and go to people's apartments and smoke reefers and go to bed at 4 or 5 in the evening and then sleep so they could get to work singing again at 2 in the morning. "We used to try to drink 24 hours a day," said Barnes, who held a clear picture of Billie raising Cain in the streets with her friends at the break of dawn, talking loud and hollering and laughing when a cop asked them to quiet down. "They wouldn't keep quiet and got louder," Barnes said. "And they wanted to lock them up, so they were screaming, 'I don't believe it, take me!' And they refused to go and sat down in the middle of the street and refused to get into the patrol wagon, so they had to bring around a police car." They were booked for disorderly conduct, but let go right away. At 16, Billie met a pianist named Bobby Henderson, a gentle man who loved and understood her. "The only man I think she ever loved in her life," said Barnes. Henderson only learned that Billie had been 16 at the time she knew him when he read her memoirs in the 1950s, for she seemed much older. "She was the kind of woman that you would admire," Henderson said. "You would say she was statuesque." "The thing that I found out about Billie was not to arouse her temper," Henderson said. "Now, she had a lot of patience, the people that she worked with and the people that she knew. But if some guy insulted her, you had it." Billie trusted Henderson enough to let her guard down with him, and at those times, she was like a little girl, as if nothing bad had ever happened in her life, to hear her laugh. She laughed from the soles of her feet to the top of her head, plus some. "I used to love to watch Billie eat," Henderson said. "She was very dainty, and Billie was, what you could say, a full-bodied woman, and she was very graceful in everything she did. She was very clean, very neat. The way she handled a fork, the way she did eat. We'd be in a restaurant, we'd be eating, and somebody would say to me, 'What's the matter with you?' I'd say, 'Nothing.' But deep in my mind, I'm saying, 'You do things in a beautiful way.'" Henderson took Billie home to meet his mother, who was very supportive of his career, and Billie took Henderson to meet Sadie. He observed their stormy relationship from a distance, trying to steer clear when they would start screaming at each other, seemingly out of the blue. "I didn't know enough about their business to have any feelings about what they were arguing about," Henderson said. "This was something I'd never understood and I never interfered with. A couple of times I'd say, 'Billie, don't holler at your mother like that,' or 'Don't argue so loud.' And I tried to say, 'Sadie,' I'd try to make an excuse, but I couldn't say anything. I made up my mind, 'Keep your mouth shut, 'cause you don't know what they're really arguing about.'" Wealthy jazz aficionado John Hammond saw Billie singing in a club around this time and was very impressed by her. Hammond said that Sadie sometimes worked for Mildred Bailey, and that Bailey liked to complain to Billie about her mother's poor housekeeping. This was Mildred's way of getting back at Billie because Billie was so good she couldn't stand it. Mildred told this to me, among other people. Clara Winston, who ran a food and drink club in Harlem on 142nd Street, said that Sadie used to run along behind Billie, crying her name, "Billie, Billie, Billie," just like a little baby or a little bird. Sadie lived vicariously through Billie, and she behaved sometimes more like a neglected little sister than a mother. The two women lived together a lot of the time, bound to each other by ties that other people couldn't understand. Billie was singing at a short-lived club run by the singer Monette Moore when Hammond saw her, and he knew right away how good she was, and wrote her up in a British magazine called Melody Maker. Hammond took people to see Billie wherever she performed in Harlem, oftentimes in brownstones. She would go from table to table and sing the same chorus of a song over and over again 40 or more times, collecting tips and building excitement each time she sang it. Hammond remembered Billie singing an early effort from lyricist Johnny Mercer called "Would You for a Big Red Apple." He loved everything about her phrasing and her regal beauty, and he knew Billie was the find of a lifetime. Hammond brought clarinetist Benny Goodman to see her, and he also brought the great British actor Charles Lofton, who got friendly with both Billie and Sadie, who seems to have helped him find some gentleman friends, and quite a lot of marijuana. Pleased with her efforts on his behalf, Lofton wrote them a check so large that Billie was afraid to cash it until several years later, when she was in desperate need of money, and decided to try the Lofton check, and she was surprised and relieved when it went through. On November 27, 1933, Hammond made sure that 18-year-old Billie was squeezed in to record with Benny Goodman at the end of a Columbia session with the cantankerous, theatrical, and competitive Broadway star Ethel Waters, who disliked Billie right away and later said that when Billie sang, she sounded like her feet hurt. Billie's first recorded song was a ditty called Your Mother's Son-in-Law, in which she references Jules Bledsoe, the star of Showboat. You don't have to sing like Bledsoe. You can tell the world I said so. She chirps in a key that is much too high for her, which Billie found comic when she talked about this initial record later in life. She sounds eager to please, sticks to the beat, and uses a bit of vibrato on certain words, and even a dying fall at the end of the tune, which would become one of her early trademarks. On her second record with Goodman, Riffin' the Scotch, another song with Johnny Mercer lyrics, she does a mordant on the word fire, which shows how much Bingness had infiltrated popular music by 1933. She was quite a pretty girl, Mercer said, but there was something about her, not just the torchy quality of her voice, that made you want to help her. 4. Frank in Hoboken. Frank Sinatra had a chip on his shoulder about many things, including the way he had been born in December of 1915. "They just kind of ripped me out and tossed me aside," he said. Forceps had been used, and so there were major scars on the left side of his face and a near-deformed left ear. Add to this a bad case of acne as a kid, and Frank often felt disfigured. To compensate, he applied pancake makeup to the worst areas on his face, and he had a fetish for cleanliness and neatness, often taking several showers daily. Frank once said that there were only two people in his life that he had ever been afraid of, the bandleader Tommy Dorsey and his formidable mother, Dolly, who campaigned for women's suffrage. Dolly had a flair for the dramatic, once chaining herself to a building during a protest in 1920, and she was known around Hoboken, New Jersey, as an all-around fixer and political operator for the Democratic Party. If there was any problem of any kind in her neighborhood, you called on Dolly. She worked as a midwife, and she provided abortions for girls in trouble, which sometimes got her arrested. Her husband, Marty, was the quiet type, a fireman who lived in his wife's lively shadow. Young Frank was somewhat spoiled or entitled, wearing fine clothes and even playing with dolls, but he had a "What did I do this time?" relationship with Dolly, who would hit him at the least provocation, and sometimes with no provocation. She once threw a shoe at him and called him a bum because he had a photo of Bing Crosby on his wall, and she could not have been happy about his copying his idol Bing in everything. Teenage Frank tried to smoke a pipe like Bing and wore a yachting cap, rigging himself up in the kind of Bing costume that had so impressed Louis Armstrong. Frank would sing sometimes on top of a player piano for tips at a tavern his parents ran in Hoboken, so he was a saloon singer from the start. He was expelled from high school, where he had arranged bands for school dances, and he also dropped out of business school. Dolly got him a job as a delivery boy at the Jersey Observer newspaper, but that didn't last, and neither did a job she found him as a riveter, for Frank was clearly more interested in performing at social clubs around town and on local radio. He was developing a lifelong bad habit of reacting with anger whenever he was caught not doing what he should have been doing, and anger and resentment would always be Frank's go-to emotions whenever guilt or remorse might have been called for instead. Dolly was a shrewd woman, and eventually she could see the writing on the wall, though she loudly disparaged the idea that he could become a singer like Bing. She later bought Frank a microphone to replace the megaphone he had been using, and she also paid for orchestrations so that he could sing a few of Bing's tunes. Young Frank and his steady girlfriend, Nancy Barbato, saw his idol sing live in Jersey City in 1933, and in later years, Frank said that while in New Jersey, Bing had been arrested and jailed in Hoboken, a not unlikely story given Bing's penchant for drinking and disorderly conduct in this period. Bing was being held in a cell below street level with windows, and a skinny young Frank supposedly got down on his stomach and told the older performer how much he loved his singing. He wanted to be a singer himself, he said, and he asked Bing for advice. But Bing was so loaded that he yelled at the young Frank to go away. 5. Ella, you're going to hear from me. A very young Ella Fitzgerald would tell her friends, "Someday you're going to see me in the headlines. I'm going to be famous." And they'd laugh and say, "Oh yeah, sure." Ella was skinny in grade school, but she could fight if she had to. She was a happy, upbeat child, always dancing in the streets and dancing outside school where she was a good student. She always knew she was going to be someone someday because she kept on saying, "I want to do something, I want to make something of myself," said her friend Charles Gulliver, with whom she often went to the Savoy Ballroom in Harlem to pick up the latest dance steps. Ella was born on April 25, 1917, in Virginia, to Temperance Tempe Henry and William Fitzgerald, who lived there with their baby for a few years. By the early 1920s, Tempe was in a relationship with a Portuguese man named Joseph da Silva, and she went to live with him and Ella in Yonkers, New York. Ella's half-sister, Frances, with whom she was very close, was born there in 1923, and by 1925 they were living in a racially mixed area of Yonkers with many Italian residents. Ella's friend, Annette Miller, remembered how much Ella loved Louis Armstrong's records and how she imitated him singing "Ain't Misbehavin'" for their friends. Young Ella also loved Bing Crosby's records, but she idolized Connie Boswell, whose rhythm numbers with her sisters had the most intricate harmonies. "My mother brought home one of her records and I fell in love with it," Ella said in 1988. "I tried so hard to sound just like her." But Ella wanted to be a dancer at this point in her life, and she would do a dance act in little clubs with Charles Gulliver. Tempe died at age 38 in 1932 when Ella was 15. She said later in life that Tempe died after getting hit by a car while trying to save a child, but her friends didn't remember that. Ella continued dancing with Gulliver after Tempe's death, and she was having problems with her stepfather, Joe da Silva, who didn't want her going out late and punished her for it. He wasn't taking good care of her, Gulliver said, and people began to talk about the situation. Finally, Ella's aunt, Virginia, took Ella in to live with her own family in Harlem. While living with Virginia, Ella became very close with her cousin Georgiana, who later became her full-time traveling companion and wardrobe specialist, and she would return to Yonkers sometimes to see Frances and her friends. Joe da Silva died, after which Frances also came to live with Virginia. What followed were two bad years for teenage Ella, years that went from bad to much worse. Having lost her mother Tempe, she found herself competing for the affection of her Aunt Virginia, and she didn't react well to this. She dropped out of school and began making extra money any way she could, performing in the streets, running numbers, and even working as a sort of lookout for a brothel. Ella was finally sent to an orphanage in the Bronx, and then to a reform school in Hudson, New York, and this reform school was segregated, with a cruel male staff. Thomas Tunney, who was the last superintendent of the school, learned that Ella had firmly rejected overtures to return as an honored guest. She hated the place, Tunney said. She had been held in the basement of one of the cottages and all but tortured. E.M. O'Rourke, who taught English at the school, remembered Ella as a fine student. "I can even visualize her handwriting. She was a perfectionist," said O'Rourke. Ella didn't sing in the choir, which was all white, but Beulah Crank, who was a house mother at the school, remembered Ella singing at a church service. "That girl sang her heart out," said Crank. 6. Baby Gumm. Frank Gumm had a beautiful tenor singing voice. He played in vaudeville and managed theaters in Cloquet, Minnesota, but he had to leave town abruptly because he was gay and his advances to young men made him unwelcome. He was accused of being a pervert, and he had to skip town and get out fast, said his singing partner, Maud Ayers. Frank met bossy, managing Ethel Milne, herself a performer who played piano and did sound effects for silent pictures, and they came close to marrying before he suddenly went off for a few months on a vaudeville tour. Ethel waited for him, and when Frank came back, they were married. They settled in Grand Rapids, Michigan. Ethel had two daughters, Mary Jane and Dorothy. And when she got pregnant a third time, both she and Frank thought seriously of trying to get her an abortion because they felt that three children would be too many. But they were dissuaded because of the difficulties involved. And so, Francis Gumm was born on June 10, 1922. For the rest of her life, these first years in Grand Rapids would be viewed as a kind of lost Eden by Francis, who was pampered by her lavishly affectionate father and known as Baby. At the age of 2.5, Baby Gumm made her show business debut on stage with her family, singing Jingle Bells over and over again, and loving the audience response so much that she finally had to be carried off. Ethel kept a portable stage with her so that Baby Gumm could get up and tap dance for anyone who wanted a show. Ethel confided to the wife of their friend, Mark Robinowitz, that she had no sexual life with Frank, who started hitting on two of the ushers of the theater he managed. When the ushers complained, the Gumm family had to leave Grand Rapids. They drove out to California in 1926, and Frank got them a tour of MGM Studios by flagging down handsome cowboy star Fred Thompson, the husband of screenwriter Frances Marion. The family settled again in dusty Lancaster, California, where Frank got a new theater to manage. At age 6, the highly confident Baby Gumm supposedly drove an audience into an uproar with her rendition of I'll Get By, and Ethel could see what she had in this little girl, even if she still had her singing in an act with her two sisters. In surviving recordings and film footage, Baby Gumm will shout, "Yes, yes," as punctuation. But in the film short, Bubbles, 1930, she seems nervous and not too polished. In the winter and spring of 1932, Baby Gumm was asked to sing at the Coconut Grove in Hollywood, where Bing had made his name the year before. "I'm going to be a movie star," Baby told people in Lancaster, where she sometimes lost friends because of Ethel's domineering control of her. Her father, Frank, was crazy about Baby, and Baby was crazy about him. But Ethel generally saw Baby as an asset to be exploited rather than a child to be loved, and she worked to instill fear in her. Ethel was giving Baby pep pills and sleeping tablets at this point, when Baby was just 9 years old, a damning piece of information confirmed by two sources, tap dancing star Ann Miller, whose mother knew Ethel, and Gumm family friend Dorothy Walsh Morrison. Frank was still sexually harassing ushers, and he was connecting with contemptuous local high school boys in Lancaster while Ethel took up with a man named Will Gilmore. Baby once walked in on Ethel with Gilmore, and she developed a strong hatred of this man. When stories about her father sometimes got back to her as an adult, she would call them a ghastly, dirty lie that had likely originated with Gilmore, the bad father figure to Frank's good father figure. The Andrews sisters were as startled and touched by Baby's very mature singing voice as everybody else was when they heard this prodigy perform, and so the sisters secured her first big break in a stage show with entertainer George Jessel, who gave the sisters a new last name, Garland. Baby Garland's life was a round of performances and auditions, many of which were unpleasant and frightening. But she had those pills her mother had given her to fortify her. 7. Diana's Dream. Ida Rosen changed her name to Diana because she felt it was prettier and more glamorous. Diana's father was a cantor, and she herself had a light soprano voice and thought about going on the stage. When I was 17, I registered with my best girlfriend to sing in the Metropolitan Opera Chorus, Diana said, but we attended rehearsal only once. It brought us home too late and worried our parents, so both of us girls gave it up and put it out of our minds. Yet Diana would still perform around the house, and when she looked in the mirror, she liked what she saw. In a TV interview from the early 1980s, when she was an older woman, Diana merrily says that she used to have a nice shape, and there is an urge to be seen somewhere inside her, an urge to perform. As a young woman, she had often sung the very romantic One Kiss from The New Moon, a Sigmund Romberg operetta that premiered in 1927 when Diana was 19 years old. This was music that was also popular in the late 1920s and the 1930s, a sort of gorging on very tasty melodies. Diana married the academic Emmanuel Streisand in 1930, but what she saw in the mirror and what she heard when she sang One Kiss stayed in the back of her mind. 8. Bing at the top. On the radio, on records, and in movies, Bing Crosby was omnipresent in 1933 in America, the voice that everybody heard somewhere or somehow. Yet with success came some calculated doubts. He was convincingly lovelorn on record, for one of the only times, on I Don't Stand a Ghost of a Chance with You, for which he has a writing credit. This is the sort of torch song that Billie Holiday and Frank Sinatra would later make their own, but while they would wallow in the emotions of unrequited love, Bing is sad but slightly above it all, and prepared to scat his despair, which lightens it. That's what listeners needed and loved him for during the Depression. Bing would record I've Got the World on a String in 1933, and Frank's later version of that song is more memorable, for with Frank you get higher highs and lower lows. But Bing's sexy reading of this tune has that slightly otherworldly positivity that made him a phenomenon in his lifetime, and untouchable, a fact of life. He was steady, and he would never be counted out. He was built to endure because he always held something back. People would argue over Frank in the 1940s and 1950s and beyond, but practically everyone was won over by Bing and what he came to represent as an American male in the 1930s. He recorded two songs from the hit movie 42nd Street, 1933, You're Getting to Be a Habit with Me and Young and Healthy, in which he brags that he is full of vitamin A and does a brief scat excursion that quotes from the Gershwin tune Lady Be Good, the vehicle for one of Ella Fitzgerald's later scat masterpieces. Bing's Young and Healthy was backed by Guy Lombardo and his Royal Canadians, pure corn, but it might be remembered that Louis Armstrong himself liked Lombardo's music.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.